and salutations. Welcome to A Conversation with Colin Was Right. My name is Colin Moriarty. This is my old friend.
Hello.
Jeremy Dunham from Psyonix. But back in the day,
yes.
From IGN, and actually the man that hired me at IGN.
That's true.
Jeremy, it's always good to see you. You're always welcome with us, of course.
Thank you. It's always good to see you, too. It's one of the things I look forward to most whenever I travel anywhere is seeing you.
Yeah, me too. We always convene. I mean, we have a tradition of going to steak dinners. We're going to do that again tonight.
Always.
And trade war stories and insider information that you wish you knew. But you don't!
I don't tell him anything really bad, just for all our partners out there.
But to be clear, I mean, we are good friends. I just want to be clear about that. I first met Jeremy when I was 18, when I was an intern at IGN. He was very nice to me. It was between my freshman and sophomore years in college. And then I came out the summer after that.
Yep.
And then time went on. I finished Northeastern. They offered me a job, and Jeremy was the first editor-in-chief I ever worked under. So you should know all that information since we are very close. So maybe we're just lying to you today. I don't know.
Yeah, I remember that time well, too, because you were so eager. You were so excited to work at IGN. And just you were super into Mega Man just as much then as you are now. Yep. And I remember, I think the first review we assigned you was the Mega Man Legacy Collection.
Yeah, it was the one, the PS2 one and the GameCube one that was all fucked up. The one with the inverted buttons that like no one could play.
But if there was anyone who was going to write it, it was you.
I was very excited. Now, I wasn't quite as curmudgeonly when I was 18, 19 as I am at 32.
It's true, you weren't. The funny thing about that time is that you were so eager just to do well that people would just be their normal curmudgeonly selves like we are now. And it would just bounce right off. It's like you didn't even notice it. You're like, whatever, what else you need me to do?
Yeah, I was excited and eager, and here I am, and now I hate everything.
Yeah.
So
age.
It is age. So as I told you in emails, and we've talked a great deal, a conversation with Colin Was Right. The idea behind this is a conversation with Colin was obviously our first show before we were even kind of funny. We killed it mercifully. But Colin Was Right is obviously our newest show. And what I've liked about it is that it's getting people to talk. For instance, we're having Adam Boys on because he takes umbrage with something I said on one of the shows. Mm-hmm. And the idea of this conversation series, which I'll do intermittently, maybe we'll do it at E3 again or something like that, is to have people on to be able to reinforce ideas or to challenge ideas kind of portrayed in those shows. And so particularly since you're a VP of Psyonix, which is a very big indie studio responsible for Rocket League, one of the great games on PS4 and elsewhere and other platforms of your choice. I figured you'd be able to add a lot of interesting stuff to the dynamics of what the indie scene is looking like today, how it is to be an independent developer and
I'm not here as your wingman, right? You want the straight.
Of course. If you like Adam Boys is probably going to kill me tomorrow. So when I record with him, so he was so mad about that particular, he took a lot of pride, I think, in what they were doing at PlayStation with third parties and stuff like that. And so, that's why that was the idea. That was the genesis of this was like, you have to come on and tell me why I'm wrong. You can be mean to me if you want.
Okay. I'm not going to be mean to you, but I will be right.
So first of all, how's everything going? How are you? Like how is San Diego? Beautiful.
I'm great. I love working for Psyonix. I work with amazing people. I know everyone always says that in interviews. Oh, I have the greatest team It really is true. The team there is so involved in just about everything we do for Rocket League, and they're so passionate about it. Even 2 years after, or a year and a half after we've come out, that it makes every idea that we have for the next thing we want to add to the game infectious. We get really excited about the next thing we're going to do, and we're doing so many things this year. This year in particular, it's going to be a big year for us. That I'm really excited just to let everyone kind of let loose and see the cool things we have. We have some really cool things coming.
Awesome. How's what? I always forget. It's Thomas that we went out with, right?
Thomas.
I liked him. How's he doing?
He's doing well. He's actually on vacation right now. Oh, okay. So he's right now. He's probably really, really,
really
happy.
Well. Yeah. He's very well. We had a very nice steak dinner with him.
Yes.
One of our many steak dinners
in Las Vegas.
In Vegas, yep, during PSX.
I think that is the day that you actually said, hey, Craig and I are leaving IGN. Yeah, we're going to start Kinda Funny.
Yeah, so the PSX that year, which was the first PSX, you guys showed Rocket League. So first of all, I like to pat myself on the back every once in a while. I was definitely the first person in mainstream media to say that Rocket League was going to be huge. There is no doubt about that. Anyone that tells you that otherwise is lying. I remember telling you that you had a little booth with like one TV or two TVs.
Yep.
I'm like, this game is fucking insanely awesome. It's going to be huge. And then I remember us talking about it later, but I'm so glad that the game's done so well. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
To you and the team, because you deserve all of the... it really is so fun. And seeing everyone embrace it is really great. I haven't played it too much since it came out because I'm so terrible at it.
Me too. Yeah, but I have no choice.
I liked playing against the computer anyway because I felt competent.
That's exactly what I do. Or I'll play my kids who are 10 and 8 and then I'll win.
And beat on them.
Ha.
So let's start with Rocket League real quick. What's you guys are obviously going to support this game into the far future, I assume, because it's doing so well.
Yeah.
So what are the plans now with that?
Right now, we don't have any cutoff date for the game. A lot of times you look at a game's development, you're like, oh, I'm going to spend 1 to 2 years of post-development support on this game, and then we'll move on to the next project. Because Rocket League is so successful and because people are still playing it in actually higher numbers than they have before, and I know I said that last time I was on the show, but for the last 3 months, December, January, February, we've broken our records month after month.
That's incredible.
It is, and we're like, great, let's keep going. In December, we cracked our record for games played and active players, and we did again in February last month, or after doing it in January, in a shortened month. And we beat the number by like 600,000 players.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
My God.
So we're happy.
You guys must be so rich with all that money you're making off of Rocket League, Jeremy Dunham.
We're doing okay. no complaints.
So, well, I like that you guys have no cutoff date for it because it reminds me of what Rockstar actually said a few months ago. Strauss Zelnick said something about how they know that they're going to have to kill Grand Theft Auto Online at some point because it'll never die on its own. And they obviously don't want attention being taken away from future games or whatever. And it seems like you guys have a great hit on your hands, more of like a game as a platform, which we always talked about with Gran Turismo or with Madden or something. We always wanted to see games go in that direction.
Yeah, and one of the problems that you have with, like, people ask us all the time, why don't you do like a Rocket League 2? It'd do very well, you'd make money over again. But that's the problem. Right now we've had almost 29 million lifetime players, right? That's how many players we have lifetime. We had about a fourth of them play our game last month. So we have a very active player base. Why would we want to take this huge community that we've already built that's still growing and just say, what you're playing now is going to be irrelevant in 12 months, but we want you to stop what you're doing, give us money all over again, and move over to this other game? That's not the right way to do things. I think that era of games is past when you have a game like Rocket League. So our goal is just to keep making Rocket League better and better so that we don't lose any of the people that want to play. And they've already given us their money, or if you're on PlayStation Plus, gave Sony their money.
Right.
But if they're playing our game, we're not going to penalize them, as it were, and make them buy our game again just because we want to add a couple new features. We want to let them know we're in it for the long haul if they're in it for the long haul. And that's our whole approach to the game, our game development. We're thinking of features that are 1-2 years out in some cases.
Awesome.
We want people to wait for it, but because our backlog of really cool things is so deep, it's going to take us that long to get everything in the game up to this point. And that's assuming we don't have any other new ideas, which we will, because we come up with them all the time.
Well, I like that you guys are taking that approach, because you are seeing, with the exception of Activision, which wants to run everything into the ground, you're seeing that with Ubisoft kind of pulling back with Assassin's Creed, for instance. Mm-hmm. But also, per your point about seeing rising numbers when you treat a game with care, Ubisoft's also seeing positive growth with things like The Division and Siege, where they were saying like a year after that actually more people are playing these games, you expect a dramatic drop down on that. So that's awesome that you guys are seeing that. And I think you're right.
It's the way that you prove to your community that you're actually committed to them, and that you let them know that while money is great, and it is great, right? You want to make money. That's why you make video games. That there's still a much cleaner and easier way for the whole community to still give you money without affecting their experience at all. It's so strange to me how many other developers haven't really caught up to that yet, and they're still kind of in the old school way of doing things, just one release after another and an annualization. I think that's a big mistake, especially the more connected people get, and as time dwindles for the aging demographic in video games, that demographic is getting older. People have less time. You don't want to invest your money and your time in something new over and over and over again. You want those old faithful games where you can sit down and just play it. And we're mindful of that.
What's the financial reality of that, though? That's the one thing I'm curious about. If you guys have 29 million players, which, by the way, is really impressive, even though that includes PS Plus players, I got it for free.
That's players, yeah.
That's a quarter of the copies that Minecraft has sold. That's not a joke. That's a significant seller. That's more than Infinite Warfare will sell.
Yeah.
And it's not a $60 game, but that's impressive numbers. Yeah. I mean, congratulations.
The one caveat for that is that combines all players. It's not necessarily sales. Sales were hovering around the 10.5.
Oh, so this is like individual people that sign in on a system.
Right. We're a co-op game, and we have split screen and things like that.
Fair enough. And people are logging in. So that's a good caveat.
So it counts PlayStation Plus, which we can't disclose.
Right.
And then on top of about 10.5 plus million copies we sold after PlayStation Plus across all the platforms.
That's awesome.
Plus, I mean, then all the co-op players.
That's
and
huge.
Like that.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
So what is the financial reality of that though? Because you guys are obviously having to serve all these online games and, you're having to support them. Once you get people in the door, giving you the money up front, are you guys seeing good DLC conversion? Are you seeing people paying for a lot of things? In other words, can you see Psyonix, even though you have other projects, I'm sure, in the works, can you see you guys kind of staying financially solvent with this game for a long time to come?
Yeah. We've seen great numbers on the Hot Wheels DLC so far. That's been out for a week. And it's our best-selling DLC since the Batmobile came out.
That's awesome.
And all
Which was a while ago. The Batmobile was a while
ago. Came out last March. Yeah. But all of our DLC has done well. But the Batmobile in particular was just a monster. It was moving units like crazy. And so the fact that they're still doing this a year and a half later is really encouraging for us. And people are spending a lot of time in the game. They're playing a lot of games. In January, we had... in December, we had almost 100 million games played in 1 month.
That's incredible.
A huge amount. So, yeah, we'll be fine because even though the game's only $20, we have all of these different ways that they can give us money through DLC. And on top of that, you have the fact that we've shown a commitment to them. And when you show that kind of commitment, people tell their friends, hey, this game is not going anywhere. It's fun. I want you to play this with me. And now they'll tell friends. And it's exactly the strategy that we had hoped would work for PlayStation Plus, which has worked for us so far. And we hope to continue that. And I believe this, and our studio believes that that's the wave of the future for games. Is that's how you make money off games? Is you prove your dedication to the product that you're releasing?
It reminds me of something that someone told me at 2K once about Spec Ops: The Line. That that there's like the game sold obviously okay. It didn't sell nearly as well as it should have. That's an amazing game, but that the tales of the game after a year and a half was actually flat, and it wasn't flat at zero. It was actually flat at like whatever it was, 5 or 10,000 copies a month. Uh-huh. I'm sure you guys are selling more than that, but you kind of answered this question already. But people are buying the game still new, so that's another revenue stream. So obviously the first 2 weeks even are pivotal when a game's launched, nonetheless, first 2 months. But you guys are seeing solid sales sometime after the game had already launched.
Oh, yeah. I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, but we sold, I think the last time I was on your show, I said that we sold more copies in the last 6 months than we did our first 6 months. Mm. That's true again. We sold more copies in the last 6 months than we did the 6 months before that.
And that's an anomaly. I mean, to be fair, like that's a huge outlier in the industry when if a game is if not a game after a month even
is going to be
basically sold through what it's going to sell.
Absolutely. We acknowledge that, but we also think that shows that it can be done. And what the other games that have had much better sales than us or have that kind of life, like Minecraft, like you mentioned, that's the same sort of game as us. Obviously not in the mechanics, but the way that the game is constantly being supported by the community or otherwise, it's a game that kind of transcends technology and release dates and who their competition is. It's a game that keeps servicing the people that love it, and they keep coming back for it, and that's the approach we want to take.
So I think, again, this kind of answers itself, but it's an interesting segue into the next part of the interview, which is the influx of capital you guys must have gotten from Rocket League allows you to take risks into other things now, right? I mean, obviously you guys were doing, as far as I remember, a lot of contract work before Rocket League. Rocket League was kind of a passion project.
Not anymore.
Yeah, now you don't have to do that anymore. Now you guys can make your own IP or get into bed with a publisher or do whatever you want to do. So what kind of freedom, like how are you exploring that freedom? I mean, can you talk about any of that specifically?
Yeah, so what we've done so far is like, and all video game development studios do this, is you have a prototype team that's running various ideas around at all times. And you try them out. You spend X amount of time. Some you can spin up in a week. Others can take months. But you have all these different ideas that you're messing with, and then you run it through a process. You see what the design team thinks. You see what the engineering team thinks, what the art team thinks. You really evaluate what kind of game it is, and you play it a lot, and you see if it's worth taking to a green lighting step. And so those are the sorts of things that we're doing post Rocket League, and we have that freedom to do it now. We're not on a lot of companies have a timeline that they have to release something in, because if they don't, the tail that you mentioned earlier is gone, and now they need some kind of source of income. Luckily, that's not our position. We can take our time, which is exactly what happened with Rocket League. That was a game built over several years of just kind of working on it in the background in between projects. It's something that we're doing now, but it's something that we can do without having to rely on anyone else but ourselves. So it's very freeing. I think the best part about it is it really kind of lets people be creative, because we're not trying to say we want to build another game like Rocket League or we want to build another game like a game we've made in the past. But we're not saying we don't want to do that either. We're just saying, let's see what we can come up with and see what sticks. And so that's the best part about it, because you can, there's, it's true freedom. You can just kind of experiment, and if you don't like it, move on to something else. No harm, no foul.
Is there like an eagerness to do, obviously you're not going to make Rocket League again. You're not going to make a similar kind of game, but with your kind of mantra on games as a service, or servicing the gamer over a long period of time, does that kind of pigeonhole you into having to do certain kinds of games? In other words, could you do like a, if you wanted to make a AAA open world game, not that you guys would do that, is that kind of out of the question, because it's not really within the realm of how you are raising capital right
it's
now?
It's a question we haven't had to answer yet. I think that the perception of some folks might be that, because, oh, well, you have Rocket League, which is a successful multiplayer-based game, but now you guys want to do an Uncharted-type game, which, by the way, we're not working on any sort of Uncharted game, but I'm using it as an example. I think that would make people pause quite a bit. Like, well, where's the background in that? What kind of history have you shown to make that kind of game? But that's really, that would be up to us as a team to convince the players and the audience that the game is good based on the game itself and the trailers and how we present the game and what. So I'm not worried about that aspect of it. I think that that kind of happens in the industry in general, but we're not worried about it. We just want to make the games that we feel good about. Because before, obviously, we're very good at multiplayer. That's what we've done most of our career. But there are other instances where we've done other things that were to help other companies. Like if you look on our company page, we helped way back when Firaxis helped work on their XCOM game on Enemy Within. So there, you know, that wasn't exactly super Twitch multiplayer.
Right.
We just like ideas. We like to mess around. And our studio is full of gamers that play all sorts of different games. And that has kind of helped influence our thinking and that we're not pigeonholed into anything.
Yeah. And it also goes without saying that you guys can hire to make to make a different kind of game. I mean, I think there was not a lot of skepticism, maybe less skepticism because of their nature. But there was some skepticism about Guerrilla being able to make Horizon, considering they made shooters for 10 years. And,
so excited
and Horizon,
about that game.
Have you not played it yet?
I pre-ordered it. I was going to play it before I left. And then I'm like, well, I'm just going to start it.
Right.
And then I'm going to have to go to GDC. So I'm going to wait until I get back.
Gonna,
I'm doing it all weekend.
Dude, it's so good.
I'm super excited. It's my kind of game, too.
Yeah. We like the couch potato immersive, leave me alone kind of shit.
The less I have to move, the happier I am. Yeah.
All right. So you guys are in good health.
Yes.
Rocket League's fantastic.
Yep.
What kind of, are you guys getting, and I asked you this question a while ago, and I want to ask you again, are you getting approached by a lot of publishers? I can't imagine that the Activisions and Ubis and EAs of the world don't want to work with you.
We've been approached by publishers nonstop since probably the first week of Rocket League's release, which is really flattering. And, you know, we never say no to the possibility of working with people.
Right.
But right now, Rocket League is such a focus, and like I mentioned earlier, we like stretching out our ideas and just trying things. That at the moment, we're just not necessarily into the idea of doing something for somebody else. It's not impossible, but...
Well, it sounds like you don't really even need their capital either. Mm-hmm. Like it seems to be more logical, even if you're going to make a $60 retail game or retail-style game, that you could probably do it yourself. You maybe need someone to distribute it. Like a Deep Silver or something, but you don't need anyone to fund it.
Maybe, or maybe we'll do it ourselves.
Yeah, all right. Yeah. All right, I like the way you think.
Yeah.
All right, so the other question I have here before we get into the kind of the industry at large is, you guys must be some sort of inspiration to other indies, right? You must get approached. How did you do it? What's the secret sauce? Are you guys kind of I imagine you have a big gravity well around you guys in terms of attracting people to ask you simple questions.
We have, and it's one of the best parts of the job. Like, because we're at GDC now. And there are people that just come up to us while we're at the booth. Stephanie, who's actually here with me right now behind the scenes, she's been at the booth all. Yeah, hi Stephanie. She's been at the booth the whole time, and people are just coming up, telling her and our other people that are working the booth just how happy they are that Rocket League exists. That it's either been a game that they've experienced that's helped them be friendlier with someone that they love or that they're close with, or it's rekindled relationships, or it's really helped inspire them to do something else. That's really cool when you have other game developers coming up and telling you that, because those are your peers telling you, I respect your work and I really like it. So I'm really happy for everyone on the team when we get those kind of comments. And it's one of the most satisfying things to hear, especially almost 2 years after release, that people are still influenced by it, and it's impacted them and it continues to impact them in ways that that we didn't think would happen in the beginning, but we're very, very glad that it did.
Yeah, I'm sure you are. All right, so let's take a while. Let's like go up to 10,000 feet now, because I want to talk about, you know, you have such a really interesting mind, a deep knowledge of the game industry that I've always respected. You know more about, you're one of the very, well, not very few, but you're one of the few people I've really encountered in my time in the industry where I'm like, you will always know more about games than me. That definitively will always
understand
more
about. I don't know about that, but thank you.
You are, I mean, your knowledge is encyclopedic, and obviously you understand the industry. You've been here for a long time. I've always respected that about you. So I'm curious about what you feel about the general health of the industry. I just put up a Colin Was Right episode to kind of segue towards something relevant to the audience here, about numbers, about PlayStation 4 at 55 million, mm-hmm. kind of slowly, almost quietly and silently creeping up to the top five best-selling consoles of all time.
Yeah.
Which, you know, once it broaches about 83 million, it'll have passed Xbox 360 and PS3.
In the dead console cycle, by
exactly,
the way.
Which is something I nailed in my last one over and over again. I went and searched on Google for all these headlines. I just looked for console gaming is dead, and then dates 2010 to 2012, and then found all these articles and just screen capped all of them and put them in the video. Because I kept saying back then, dead serious, like, if consoles are dead, then I'm out. I'll just go do something else. I'm not playing, you know, PC games and phone games. So do you feel like this is ephemeral, or do you feel like this is permanent? In other words, the PS4 success is significant, but Xbox One obviously lagging far behind Xbox 360's numbers at this point in its cycle, and will have no prayer of even reaching 50 million when Xbox 360 did 83 million, and obviously Wii U is 87 million short of Wii. So there are mixed numbers there, but what do you think of the health of the industry?
I think as long as there's the need to play games and there is an easy way for people to play games that is either inexpensive, easy to hook up, to turn on, and to experience with, especially people of younger ages or older ages, there'll always be some kind of need for a console or a console-like machine. I think the world is definitely savvier now than it was when you and I started in the industry. At that time, consoles dominated everything, and PC was just kind of on the periphery. And at that time, remember, PC gaming was dead.
Right, exactly. When Crysis came out, it was a resurgence in a way.
Exactly. And remember when Steam first came out, everyone was like, oh, this is, who's going to buy digital games?
Right.
So I think that there's always going to be a place for consoles. That's a really long way of saying I don't think this is a one-off. I do think that there's still going to be a lot of life left in them. But I think that, like the game industry and the game, like Rocket League and Minecraft and other games, what form that could take could change over time. I mean, for example, you look at something like the streaming bet that Sony made on the Gaikai purchase, right? That was something that everyone really expected to take off much quicker than it has. But everyone and their uncle thought for sure that was the wave of the future. And so far, it's proven not to be quite yet.
In fact, it seems like a sunken cost to a lot of people. They spend $400 million on the technology, and PlayStation Now is almost irrelevant. So it is an interesting kind of, it's a dice roll.
And on the flip side, you have Microsoft, who's done the backwards compatible games on the Xbox 360 on Xbox One. And now, you know, they're saying that we want you to always feel like you have access to these games. They've introduced their new Xbox Pass this week.
But they're making, I actually think Microsoft's making awesome moves with that kind of stuff.
And that's cool too. And so I'm excited about that as a gamer. But then there's the question of what is that going to do to digital sales, as it were, once this passes out? What is that going to do to those games? How are those games going to be selected and included in that process? And is that going to change the gaming habits of anyone who is either a subscriber or who is a frequent consumer of digital games in their current form? I think the honest answer is I don't know. I have no clue. I have ideas. But I think that if you try to predict the industry too far ahead of time, you're almost always going to be wrong, because historically that's what's happened. The death of PC gaming didn't happen. The death of consoles didn't happen. Streaming gaming did not take over all games.
Right. Mobile gaming is obviously very profitable, but still relevant to the people that play those other games, et cetera, and so on. Social gaming obviously died on Facebook. So.
It's proven that the hardcore gaming group isn't going to go over to Facebook and mobile just because that's what everyone's telling them they're eventually going to do. That's not what happened, and that's not what's going to happen, in my opinion.
No. I mean, I think you're clearly right on that point.
And I think that's what's both cool and can be frustrating about video games is that you can only plan so far in the industry before something happens or comes along that changes everything. VR right now at GDC, almost every game on the floor is VR. And the funny thing is before VR came out, everyone was like, we'll see.
Yep.
And now they're moving from we'll see to, oh, wow, PlayStation VR sold almost 1 million units, and that's ahead of projections. That's That's pretty good.
Yeah, I think people are conflating, and I think reasonably so, maybe engagement with VR, or at least chatter with VR, with sales. And when you see the sales of HTC Vive and with Oculus, which are a combined 500,000, and then you see 915 or 920,000 for PS4, like you said, 2 months ahead of the schedule in which they wanted to be at a million, and they're supply constrained, it shows a lot of positivity there too. And I think people are excited about new ways to play in the hardcore space.
Exactly. And the thing, and one, this, the cynical way to look at that is, well, that's only 1.5 million VR customers out there. Well, but think about it. That's ahead of projections of what they thought they would do. And when Rocket League came, I know I keep coming to Rocket League.
Well,
but
it makes sense.
Yeah. When Rocket League came out, there were only between 23 and 25 million PS4s out there. Now there are 55 million PS4s out there. And that's in 2 years. We've doubled the audience that we can get to. If VR audience doubles every single year, for even the next 2 years, all of a sudden, that's a really big audience that you can start making games for and you can start promoting. So I think that it's also, I think there's a lot of opportunity there and a lot of applications for VR outside of just gaming too. I think that that's where it's really going to take off in some of the other.
I agree with you, absolutely.
The other areas.
Visual, tourism and concerts and whatnot.
In space. People want to go to space. Yep. If you could put someone in one of the missions to Mars and you let them look around virtually, or you have relatives that you haven't seen in a while and you can give them something they can, you, instead of Skype, where you can interact with them individually, those are all things that could really take off that you don't even need games for, but the technology can thrive. Had you given that scenario to me 2 years ago, I would have been waffling. I'm like, I don't know about that. But now I'm becoming a believer. And I think that's the game industry in a nutshell, is 2-3 years from now, who knows what's going to be, where it's going to be going. But I think that the one thing that's proven historically from the beginning of games to right now is people always want something once they can have it, once video games existed, if it's easy to get to, that's one market. If it's the hardcore enthusiast, it's another. These audiences are always going to exist, and until that magical device comes together that's immediately customizable, can be done in the drop of a hat, and anyone of any age can understand it immediately, you're going to have the need for diversity in system types, including consoles and PCs.
The one kind of, I'm playing with this idea in my mind, I'm not sure exactly how to say it, is like the financial imperative, obviously, like game development isn't altruistic, so people need to make money in order to survive, and they want to make a profit and make another product. The only harbinger of bad things to come that I can see happening is like is multi-tiered. Like, for instance, with VR, the numbers are small, which is positive, and they're growing, but which is positive for the future of VR. But there seems to be like, it's like almost stillbirth, in the sense, if no one makes money making the games, if you only have 1 million people and 2% of the people buy, I mean, you're not making any money. The same thing with these passes, like you talked about, that are going to dilute the value of digital games, presumably. And then you have issues from there in terms of, I guess like with Rocket League, you guys are making money, but there's only so much space and time for people to play all these games. So for every Rocket League that persists in that space, you have whatever that game, Dead Star, and all these games that come and go, that there's no time. Destiny is going to suck all the oxygen up. Call of Duty is going to suck all the oxygen up. Is there any concern there that the game is a platform, or kind of this ubiquity that we have now is going to kind of cannibalize itself?
That's a good question. I think that the reality is the video game market worldwide, no matter where you go, it's just capitalism at work, and that's just the way capitalism works.
And it's beautiful.
I'm a big fan of capitalism myself. But I think that that's always been the scenario, and it always will be. And I think that if it's just a reality that you're gonna have to deal with, you have to take chances in games. I'm gonna not mention our games. Okay. But you have to take chances. If there had never been Steam, what would have happened to the idea of digital games in general? How much later would that have started to become a reality, and retail would still dominate? And without that, and without even mobile and the ease that independent developers could start uploading games, where would we be now in the ecosystem of developing games, where anyone can literally make their own game versus having to rely on millions and millions of dollars for 20, 30 releases a year? That probably wouldn't have ever happened without each of these things happening. So it's a very convoluted way from talking in a circle. But
we sometimes do that.
Yeah, it's.
I'm sure we'll do that at dinner later.
I just think it's a reality. You have to take chances. Yep. You have to be prepared that you can fail. If you're not ready to fail, if you're not ready to accept the reality that people might not play your game, people might not pay for your game, and it's possible it could not hit the levels of popularity you're hoping, you're not going to go anywhere, because now you're hedging all your bets. You might not be able to do creatively what you want to do. Or worse, you're going to do what everyone else does because you think that's what sells. And now you're just a Me Too game and there's nothing special or interesting about your game. And so I think that that's what par for the course is. People like to mention, okay, I lied, I'm going to mention our game. People like to mention Rocket League as an overnight success. It was an overnight success that took more than a decade to make because Psyonix had to go through the so many trials and tribulations of getting to the point to where we could release that game, working on contract jobs and working it on the games in the shadows. And we released the first Battle Cars game on PlayStation 2008. And it did okay for the time, but it wasn't like this level. And most people, most publishers, most companies would say, well, we've already proven that it doesn't work. Why would we want to do it again? And the reason that we wanted to do it again is because we believed in it and we wanted to do it again better. And once that happened, other people could then believe in it too. So it's just, it's a war of attrition and you have to be prepared for disappointment and maybe really, really bad lows. But if you succeed, then the highs are really, really high.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I mean, I think we see the evidence all around us in the industry of the Me Too kind of shit going on. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've seen it for many years with, I think more recently with the Retro Revival, which was kind of run into the ground, or the first-person shooter movement, which was run into the ground. And now we're seeing, I think, open worlds, which are going to get run into the ground very shortly as well. And then player agency, I think, is the new thing that's going to get run into the ground. When I saw Uncharted 4 even have meaningless choices in the game, like put in there during conversations with Drake and whoever, I'm like, why? Like, it surprised me actually to see Naughty Dog do that because they usually are the leaders and not doing shit like that.
Why do you think they did do it?
My take personally is that it was supposed to give emotional closure to Drake's story, like give people some control over it, but it just seemed very forced to me. It didn't seem Uncharted to me at all. You know, like I was so afraid actually, and I thought they showed so much restraint, which is why they're one of the greats, which is I was like, please don't put any of the Last of Us shit in Uncharted. And I don't mean that thematically. I mean, like, I don't want any customization. I don't want weapon leveling. I don't want any of that kind of stuff. And they showed restraint there, but then randomly pulled this other thing out of the ether where I'm like, this doesn't fit, in my opinion.
So I took it a slightly different way. As the reason I felt that they put it there was because all the Uncharted have been these self-contained Indiana Jones movies that have their own kind of ups and downs and personal connections with different players. And it just kind of struck me as their attempt to, without having something like a Mass Effect style save system,
right,
to allow the player playing this final chapter to kind of personalize what it meant most to them in the previous installments. That's how I took it.
Greg would agree with you, by the way. Yeah.
Excellent. Yep. Thank you, Greg. But I think that is, I don't know. I like to consider myself an optimist, though. I don't think that a company like Naughty Dog, for example, developers like that, or Valve, that they necessarily do things because other people are doing it. I think they typically put things in their game because they truly believe in what they're doing is going to make their game better. And you know, every now and then you might have a feature like that some people have split opinions on, but that's okay. Everyone else likes the rest of most of their other decisions. Yeah. So it's okay if you have one every now and then that's a little controversial.
Yeah, you can't win them all.
Yeah.
So you have a horse in this particular race that I want to talk about, which is like kind of the health of the indie sphere and discoverability. And what I see as, and I dedicated an episode of Colin Was Right to it somewhat controversially. Again, Adam Boyce took umbrage with it. Mm-hmm. And we're having him on to talk about this too. And I'm trying to get a lot of people's different opinions on this that understand this better than I do. It seems to me that to me, the App Store and Google Play Store and stuff are lost. They're done. Like, and I know that they make a lot of money, but when you have 700,000 games on your storefront, I hope you make money on them. And when there are 2 billion devices that can play those games in the world, I hope you make money on them. So I don't really take that seriously. And I undercut that in a video I did where I'm like, I'm not really impressed by these numbers where they say, well, a third of all gaming revenue comes from mobile. And I'm like, but there are 2 billion devices in the world and 750,000 games. So I hope that you make some money on them.
Yep.
But the thing that really gets me concerned is I see that bleed happening now, that race to the bottom, no controls on quality, no controls on plagiarism, even on asset flipping. And I'm seeing that infect PSN and XBLA more and more. And obviously Steam, I think, is becoming a sinking ship in that respect too. I think that they're always going to make money and always be fine, but they don't care about quality anymore. Are you concerned about that as someone who kind of, you have to rely on some sort of discoverability and some sort of understanding that your game needs to sit next to some bullshit on the store that might obscure the ability of the player to find it?
It's a two-pronged answer. I think as a consumer, I'm actually more concerned than I would be as someone who works for a game developer. As a consumer, it makes it harder for me to find the games I'm looking for, or I'll see a game that looks really interesting and then that's nowhere near what I thought it was. And I have been noticing the number of times that that's happened to me has been increasing over the last, let's say, 2 years, I think, roughly. From the other side of it, I think that we have the benefit. So it's kind of an unfair advantage now, I think. We have the benefit of having the Rocket League success to where if we released another game that we would have some of that goodwill and that name recognition where people would be on, they'd be a little bit more inclined to find our game when they're looking for it. If I was an indie studio that didn't have a pre-release that had any kind of accolades or anything, then I would be concerned. I do wish there was more curation on all the storefronts the way it used to be. And not necessarily because of a quality issue alone either. It's just, there's something comforting in only having so many choices. I don't know what it is. I think it's maybe because I think it might be a reflection of my age, actually, and the fact that the fewer choices I have to make, the more efficient I feel, because you know I can't waste energy. Who knows how much time I have left? But I also at the same time in our game we're all about giving the player tons of choices. We have literally hundreds of billions of possible combinations on the customization side. 99.99% of that I'm never going to see myself, and I only want my particular configuration. But somebody somewhere might think they're going to like it. And a lot of people didn't think they were going to like Rocket League before it came out and it took off. A lot of folks were really apprehensive about it, didn't give it the time of day. And so maybe that's what some of the games coming out now are a reflection of, are people saying, well, maybe this game's going to take off. And even though we don't think it's so great, maybe there'll be some kind of niche market out there that this will become the next out of nowhere game, like Neo.
Right, which you know, sold a million copies and was supply constrained as well. And I think that's a problem. I still have, I wish I knew why the hell Tecmo Koei let that game go. Like, I don't understand. Like at the last minute, it was very weird. Like it was a very, I don't know.
Yeah, it's, I don't know either, but I'm sure Sony's very happy.
Yeah, I'm sure they are because I feel like I'm a high quality goalie. Nothing gets by me in the PlayStation world with news. And that got by me. Like when we were doing PS I Love You, I think it was the week before when we got Neo and I saw the splash screen. What it was we went to Tecmo Koei to get codes and they're like, we're not publishing it. Sony's publishing it. I'm like, when the hell did that happen?
It was only in America though, right?
Yeah. I was like, but why? Like, don't you?
Did they have an explanation?
No, we never figured out why. And I assume Sony just bought it, but at least for domestic distribution. But I always thought that was a weird one. But I guess my argument with the, you know, kind of coming from the other side of this marketplace phenomenon that I think we're seeing on PSN is I don't understand who this serves. Like what you're saying is interesting. And I think true that there's something for everyone. Right. But, you know, I had Dan Adelman on, who you know, and he was saying when he was at Nintendo and WiiWare was kind of nascent but still growing, like there would be games on there that would sell literally 50 copies in a mm-hmm. week. And you have to wonder at some point, that had to go through certification on PlayStation Network, that needs to go, the trophies need to be attached and uploaded, all these kinds of things have to, assets need to be created, a PlayStation blog post needs to be, you know, crafted. And a game, you know, I know for a fact there are games on PSN that have sold hundreds of copies. And it's like, who does this serve? At some point, Sony's actually must be losing money on these games. And wouldn't they actually, like, if you are selling 500 copies of a game at $5 a piece and mm-hmm. Sony's taking 30% of that, Sony is losing money by putting that game up. And I feel like there are so many games, like a good amount of them, maybe one in four on the PSN that are completely irrelevant that don't need to be on there. And I wonder, like, well, who does it serve really at the end of the day?
Maybe it's, and I don't know, this is, and I've actually wondered the same question, but maybe it's the new bullet list war. You know, for the longest time, it's always been, in similar genres, it's been a race to see how many features you can cram into your game. So if you remember when shooters were super big at the top of, everyone's trying to do a shooter in like 2006, 2007, 2008, that era. Bullet lists of what features in the game kept getting longer and longer in an effort to compete with each other. Maybe this is now an era where first parties are trying to compete with each other by having the most possible games available so that you have as many choices as possible so they can say, oh, you don't want to go to this platform because we have that game over here too. That's the best way that I can rationalize it. I don't know if that's the truth, but that's the only way that I could say would be a rational explanation for the lack of curation on the platforms. We have as many choices as possible. We want to make sure that you understand that when you come to our marketplace, you can get whatever you want, anything you want, as opposed to saying, oh, if I go to PlayStation only, I'm not going to be getting these 20 games that are only on Xbox and vice versa. So that's the only way I can rationalize it. The honest answer is I have no idea why that is happening more and more over the last couple of years. That's my best guess, though.
Yeah, I think. I mean, I think there must be something to it. The idea. I think. Well, it's okay. I think there's a path to least resistance that we're seeing with I think the publishers, and I feel like my personal take, and you know, I know you have personal relationships with these publishers, and I'm not trying, or the first parties, I'm not trying to, you know, injure that in any way. But it seems like people are asleep at the switch, like with a lot of this stuff. When I look at, there was literally a game, I can't remember the name of it, that went up on PSN a few months ago that was literally stolen, with stolen assets in it and all this kind of stuff. There was that game Life of Black Tiger. Did you see the trailer for this game?
Abysmal
looking game that maybe was from the PS1 era. It looked like that was awful. And at some, do you think? And this is an interesting question because you were a critic. You're the only person I think on the that we're gonna have on this week that was a critic like I was.
Okay.
So this is a question we always talked about: objectivity versus subjectivity. Yeah. That the opinions and the scoring and all this kind of stuff was subjective. Is there no objective measure of a game's quality? Because the older I get and the longer I go, I'm like, there actually is a sliver of objectivity in a sea of subjectivity to say, like, this might not really be for anybody, actually.
So here's what's interesting is that I can only speak to our own process and what we've gone through. But there's definitely been a quality control check on the Xbox and PlayStation. On Steam, it's more developer. It's similar to the App Store, where they're trusting the developers to do their own thing, and it's much a quicker process. There's no certification, but on Xbox and PlayStation, on both platforms, we were given from the time we submitted all the way until we came out, multiple QA passes by their QA mentioning things that they thought could be improved. They had suggestions in the early days of when Rocket League was first submitted to them, when we submit our game design doc to them to let them know this is what we're coming out. They go over it. They say, this is cool. This is how you could expand on this feature. They give you advice. It's just part of the way that it's set up. So in our experience, there was a definite quality check and suggestions on how to improve the game or things that they thought would take away from the game. And as we went through each QA process leading up to release, that came up time and time again. This is not working. Is this how it was intended? They would question us. Is this by design or is this a bug? Quite often. So at that time, that was 2015, at that time, there was a definite checks and balances system set up.
Do you think that was, I don't know the nature of the conversation you had, but is that common to go through that many QA steps? Because obviously certification is something every game has to go through. And that's like a Byzantine, like your trademark symbols off and all this kind of shit or whatever, you know, like the random shit that you have to do. The PlayStation is not, logo is not, you know, on the screen or whatever.
It's only common if you're submitting over and over again. So every time you submit your game, you are making yourself eligible to be evaluated top to bottom on what you're submitting. If you like our first patch for Rocket League that we released to fix the servers when we came out, because we had so much more traffic than we thought, and we literally rewrote our network code. When that patch came out, it was an emergency patch. We put it through because there's a system you can set that up for. But we had to go through the same scrutiny that we would if we were adding new content at that time. Eventually, you hit points to where they know your game so well that they can go through it much quicker than in the old time. And there's a lot of auto checks and things that they can do. But it felt odd in the beginning because there was so much that we had to go through time and time again. And we had dates. We're like, we have to get this out. Oh, man, are we gonna miss this? But now as we've been through the process on PlayStation and Xbox so many times, it doesn't feel out of place at all. It feels normal. It feels like that's the way it's supposed to work. If you're coming from PC only, where you just or apps where you just publish whatever you want to, whenever you want to, then it definitely feels out of place. And that's kind of what Psyonix had done for the most part. So it was a bit of a learning and growth period, but it, at least in our experience, that's how it works. And it seems normal. And in talking to other devs, they go through the same stuff.
Okay, that's good to know. That's good insight. All right, so I wanted to spend the waning minutes on another subject that you and I are always PlayStation centric, and that's true. But I have a Nintendo heritage. You do too, and I think a lot of us older people at this point, I guess I can call myself an older person in this industry. You know, there's look on YouTube. There's 16-year-olds and 20-year-olds talking about games that have thousands of more subscribers than we do. So. Yeah. But what do you think of Nintendo right now? This is kind of where I want to wrap things up with you. Mm-hmm. I obviously dedicated a couple early episodes of this series to Nintendo, and I am very skeptical of the Switch. So I'm curious what you... I'm not skeptical of Zelda, which is a 98 on Metacritic, which is almost unheard of. For context for people, The Last of Us, which I considered one of the best games, you know, with the exception of BioShock, maybe the best game of the last 10 years, 95 on Metacritic. So 98 on Metacritic is impressive.
Yes.
But I'm very skeptical of the Switch, and I'm very skeptical of what Nintendo's doing. How do you feel?
I think I've actually gone back and forth on it. I've had moments where I'm like, oh, I don't know if this is going to work. And then I have other moments where I get what they're trying to go for. Right now, they're in an environment where you have Xbox and PlayStation, which are powerhouses, and they're very specifically aimed at the hardcore market, and they're out trying to outmuscle each other with each new release. And then you have Nintendo, which I think their best chance at competing is to do something very, very different from them. Because I think if they do something that's, let's just say it's PlayStation 4 power equivalent, but Nintendo games are coming out on it, that's awesome, right? People would be super excited about that. But what is their hook, as it were, to get people in from different age demographics or who already own those other systems? Would they really want to buy this other system just to play the same games they're already playing in the same way as they're already doing it to get Mario and Zelda once or twice a year, right? At least this way they can say, well, we're giving developers an option to try new things the same way that they did with the original Wii. We can maybe get a different demographic, and we can be the system you buy in addition to a PlayStation and an Xbox or an Xbox. So I that to me is the tactic, is that it's not a replacement for a system. It's trying to be find a relevant reason to be purchased in addition to one you already own, while also reaching out to an audience that might not be buying those other systems to begin with. So in that way, it really intrigues me. I think their big challenge is the same challenge that Nintendo has had since the GameCube days, and that's they need very strong third-party support. Without the strong third-party support, it's going to look like a very small library. With a small library, people don't have confidence. They don't have confidence. They're not going to buy the system, and it just keeps feeding itself over and over again.
It seems like a chicken and egg scenario. Yeah. Because I agree with you. It is intuitive in one respect and unintuitive in another respect in my mind to do what the others are doing. But then it begs the question, does this device need to exist at all? In other words, like I've kind of started playing with the idea of, and I have a Switch pre-order coming. We're recording this actually on the eve of Switch launch. I was very reluctant about it, but I'm excited about Zelda and it looks great. And I don't really never, ever want to play the Wii U ever again. So I'd rather just buy this new console. But I've been playing with the idea of like, when you look at the trends, as you know, NES sold more than SNES, which sold more than N64, which sold more than GameCube. And it was the Wii that was the anomaly. But then if you remove the Wii then and go from GameCube to Wii U, then lower than that. And in other words, it seems like hardcore Nintendo fans can't sustain this ecosystem alone. And if you, unless, you know, success is dictated as 15 million units sold, which clearly it isn't. And this is the conundrum I think they find themselves in. In other words, I wonder... And people have talked about this for so long, and it seems actually within grasp, and it seems so real. Like, would they just be better off as the path of least resistance to just make these games for other consoles?
As a fan, that's what I don't know if you remember, but way back when before even the PS3 came out, as a fan, that's what I wanted. I wanted them to go through. I'm like, Sega went third party. They're out of the hardware business. Maybe Nintendo will go third party too, and they'll start releasing games on all platforms. And I still believe that if Nintendo was to go third party and release on everything, they'd break all of Grand Theft Auto's records with the Mario on all platforms or Zelda.
Oh yeah.
But you know, at the same time, I understand that they have created something that no one else has done. They really, after the video game, again, another example of the video game market dying, after the video game market died after Atari, they single-handedly resurrected that thing from... so that it was synonymous to say, I'm going to go play Nintendo, meant I was going to go play video games. That is something that once you build that, it's very hard to let go. And it's very hard to lose the idea that you can't do it again. And they have done it. It seems like a long time ago in video game terms, but they've done it as recently as 2006 with the Wii.
Right.
And if you go back to what I mentioned earlier about how we now have the freedom to experiment with multiple things in our prototyping team, they're kind of in the same boat. They did so well with the Wii, they can actually take chances and see what happens, and it's okay if it doesn't hit the same kind of numbers that a PlayStation 4 would hit. I will say this, what's interesting to me, and I was actually talking to some coworkers about this because we're all talking about who pre-ordered Switch and who didn't, and earlier in the week, and when the Wii was announced, everyone at the IGN office, except for Matt Casamassina and Fran, were like, "What is this? What's happening? It's called the Wii. I don't know about this." No one had any confidence in it at all. And it went on to be the best-selling console ever. And then at the same time, or
second best,
if PlayStation's one. But on the flip side, when Wii U was coming, everyone's like, "This is going to be awesome."
Yep, I remember. Yeah,
this is going to be great. And it didn't do anything close to what everyone predicted. So you never really know with Nintendo. They have a habit of surprising you no matter which side of the fence you're on. And I'm willing to give them a chance as a longtime Nintendo fan. I mean, that's what got me into video games. Final Fantasy and Star Tropics and Zelda and Metroid.
Star Tropics, Kid Icarus. Nice.
I love those games. Yep, yeah. Yep, Clash of Demon Head. Yep. You know, these are all games that made me fall in love with gaming. And so I have that inner fanboy in me that's never going to go away. But
I do too.
All their pre-orders are sold out.
Yep.
That says some, obviously all the pre-orders, but at least there's interest right now.
Yeah, it's definitely not tacit interest. I they are the masters of fusing that blue ocean strategy with infamous supply constraints that they do on purpose. And I'll be interested to see, you know, the Wii era was the worst with that, where they could clearly manufacture more of these things. They were not didn't even have DVD drives in them. They weren't that complicated. But I agree. I agree with you. I always have NES is still my favorite console ever, and that comes from a PlayStation, you know, fan through the roof, PlayStation fan. Yeah. And I always want them to do well, but I'll be skeptical. I'm skeptical of this thing, and I'm going to be skeptical of it until they prove otherwise. I would be surprised if this thing's even sold more than Wii U.
You should be skeptical. Skeptical. That's a new word. You should be skeptical because based on what happened with Wii U, I think that's the right reaction. But I'm also hopeful because the one thing I want more than anything is I just want that same. Nothing's more powerful than nostalgia ever.
Sure.
And I want that same feeling that I had then now when I play a new Mario game or a new Zelda game or Metroid. I'd love Kid Icarus would come back one day.
Yeah.
Anything.
They tried and it didn't work out very well, that 3DS one.
Yeah.
It was 3DS. And obviously, I mean, to their credit, because we're talking about declining hardware numbers, their worst selling handheld is at 60 million units. Yes. So it's a very different story. I mean, obviously GBA was kind of the plug pulled on that, but it still sold well. And so they have obviously a very successful hardware tradition mm-hmm. on the handheld side for sure, which is why I'm so confused why they keep saying this is a console. This is a console. This is a console. I'm like, just call it a handheld or have a different name because no one cares about your consoles. They want a handheld that can play Pokemon. They want a handheld that can play Mario, even though that Mario game is super fucking creepy. I know everyone's really excited about it, but when I saw the human person next to Mario in that new Donk City scene, I was like, this is very unsettling. Like to say the least.
It still looks good to me. I still want to play it.
I'm going to play the shit out of it. I don't believe it's coming out this year, but we'll see. Okay, so I agree with you on the Nintendo point. We had a good conversation about indies. Obviously, Psyonix's success is meteoric and well-known, and we congratulate you on that as well.
Thank you.
You know that you're always welcome with us whenever you want.
Awesome.
Gamescast, Game Over Greggy Show, and whatever. P.S. I love you.
Save some hotel fees next time.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, well, you can obviously literally stay with us if you wanted to. Or you can just stay
right
in this.
Here.
You can just stay here.
This is very impressive, but for those of you watching at home, I thought that this was like a green screen. This is a full LED screen.
Yep, it's an LED wall.
It's awesome.
I remember, so, you know, we vote on everything, the four of us, or vote, you know, try to, not always literally, but we always talk about the decisions we're making, the money we're spending. And I'm often outvoted 3-1. because I'm very conservative with with the money. And they were like, we're going to spend, I don't know, it was $40,000 or something on this thing. Trust us, it will look great and it's going to make us money because of X, Y, and Z. And I was like, no, there's no way. Let's just get a Greg and I always say if it was just him and I and not Tim and Nick who have actual eye for aesthetic and knowledge of production, we would be in front of a webcam like crammed in our spare bedroom still. So thank God for them.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, Tim and Nick.
Yeah. We'd have a very fly-by operation here. Fly-by night. Jeremy, I love you.
I love you too, man.
Thank you so much for joining us. Remember, go play Rocket League by Psyonix. If for some reason you haven't yet, you could follow Jeremy on Twitter at Dunham Smash.
Yes.
I'll see you at, are you going to be at PAX East or you'll be at E3? You'll probably be the next time I see you after that.
I won't be there. I will be at South by Southwest. I'm going to be on a panel there.
Oh, cool.
But we will be at PAX East. Psyonix will.
Okay. And cool. I'll probably swing by the booth then and say hi to the guys. All right. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time. Goodbye.